Every decade has its standouts in TV, music, and culture. Think about Seinfeld, Friends, Game of Thrones. They have all defined cinema and television for generations of enthusiasts. And now comes Squid Game, based in South Korea and taking the world by storm. This now iconic Netflix series quickly became the most watched TV program of all time, on the most popular streaming platform of all time, captivating audiences of all ages from every part of the world. Joining us today are VIPs 1, 2, 4, and 6. And I, Jeffrey Giuliano, coming to you to talk about our experiences in making television history. Thank you for joining us. I got a feeling you'll be satisfied with today's program.
Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today at REG Podcast. This is Isaiah Diesel, joined with my partner in crime, Earl Grey. And Earl Grey, how are you doing today?
Very good, mate. And yourself?
Very good. Have you got a chance to check out the Squid Game?
Definitely. I heard the hype. It was fantastic. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Yeah. And I'm actually joined today with a very good friend of mine, Michael Davis, a.k.a. VIP number one.
Or and by the way, just for the record, I was VIP one.
I wasn't paying attention. Is that what you calling VIP one?
Yeah, I did. Actually, Mike is though VIP six.
I'm the bottom VIP.
That's right.
The only time I'll ever be more important is when you introduce me ahead of these other guys.
Yeah. So you want to give a quick like 1 minute introduction, please?
Yeah, I'm Victor Overfluffin. I do a little bit of everything, the least of which is acting. I put that very low at the bottom of my list because I don't put anywhere near the effort into it that these other guys do. So,
but
move on.
Yeah, John, would you mind introducing yourself, please?
Yeah, I'm John Michaels, although I added a D to my name because of the SAG, or I guess it's just IMDb. I checked to see if there was another John Michaels, and of course there was like 50. So now I'm John D. Michaels, which is very exciting. And yeah, I'm an actor here. I was VIP one in Squid Game. I make my living as an actor and sometimes model because I'm so handsome. Other than that, yeah, I don't know. You'll have to probe me for the rest, I guess.
You were actually had the model, correct? The lion face?
Yes, I was the lion.
My name is Daniel C. Kennedy. I am a voice, film, and TV actor who is working out of Seoul. Born and raised in the States, country boy. Grew up in a town of about 7,000 to 8,000, farming community named after a racehorse called Dexter. Grew up right next door to a cornfield. Yeah.
I'm Jeffrey Giuliano. I play VIP 4. I'm a writer and an actor. And a vegan.
And a Hindu.
Well, we're not really Hindu. I'm a Gaudiya Vaishnava. That's a whole separate thing. It's, go ahead.
We like to start first and foremost with a friendly fire round. So we're just going to ask you guys a few questions. And you guys ready?
Yeah.
All right. So if you guys are served one meal, your last meal, what would it be on death row? Start here with Mike.
Oh, I would have a good old American hash brown and egg breakfast with sausage, not Asian sausage, and bacon.
I'm not a vegan, but I am mostly vegetarian, and I eat beans constantly, and you might think you'd get sick of them, but I never do. And these days, though, I have been making my own corn tortillas. So I think maybe a corn tortilla with some of my freshly made refried beans with a little salted cabbage on top. Something simple like that.
Campbell's tomato soup and 2 toasted cheese sandwiches.
Cheese?
You wouldn't even break the vegan
cheese,
diet.
All right.
Chili cheese and steak burrito with cinnamon crispas, because I love Mexican food, and also if I'm going to be executed by the state, I'm going to leave a big mess for them to clean up, you know?
All right, here we go. Next one. If you guys got stranded on a deserted island, what would be the one item you would want with you?
Boat.
Great answer. John?
I mean, I think that's the only answer, isn't it? I mean...
Hey, what about
how about an airplane? I'm going to say an airplane.
Copy of the Bhagavad Gita.
So let's start first and foremost and tell us how you got involved with Squid Game and what was that experience like? Start off with Mike since he's here.
Oh, I actually, about 6 months before I got the word, I read this part. Mm-hmm. It came from some agent I'd never heard of and that I had no idea what I was reading for. Turns out it was pretty much a lot of what VIP4 did. And I completely blew that.
You don't want to be naked. You don't want to be naked.
I would have been happy to be naked, but I just wasn't sure it was a legit production. And completely blew that audition. And then like 6 months later, I guess they added an extra VIP. Mm-hmm. And they said, hey, if you're available, you got it. I had no lines, so nobody cared.
I think it was a cold read. I'm pretty sure it was a cold read. We went in and they gave us a script there. And so we had like a couple minutes to look at it. And then I did it. And the original audition script, I think for all of us, the original audition script was an amalgam of all the VIPs. So it was like bits and pieces of all of them. And then, so I auditioned once. And then apparently the casting agents that had been hired were summarily fired and they got a new casting agent. And then I was approached by another agency and this time I put it on tape and the script they sent me was still an amalgam, but they had changed the script somewhat. And it was much closer to what ended up being the final script and or portions of it. And put myself on tape for that. And then they were just still looking. And apparently what I'm gathering is they were looking for VIP4 and they were not. So I apparently had been cast a long time earlier, but they were still casting about and they were like asking friends of the director and friends of friends and friends of the producers were like just contacting different actors and then they were asking around. So I was getting all these contacts from all these different people. Hey, can you audition for this? And I was like, I already sent it. I auditioned twice already. So I sent my tape in again, but, and then months later, yeah, I ended up getting VIP1. But what I took from that is that they were having a hard time finding somebody for VIP4. Which leads us in a perfect segue into Jeffrey Giuliano's story.
Well, I had been brought over maybe a year earlier to do a movie called Peninsula Train to Busan for Netflix. And the story I heard was the director saw me in that and then invited me to do a tape, which I did. I've even put that successful casting tape on my YouTube channel, Jeffrey Giuliano channel. And I was invited, to come over. There was a lot of contract negotiations and they broke down. And I said, okay, because, you know, I don't really care. I've done so many movies and, you know, if they want to hire me, they're going to have to pay me what I want. And that it broke down and they said, well, okay, maybe in the future. I said, okay, whatever, man. And then they came back to me about 2 weeks later, gave me the money I wanted and the conditions I wanted. And then I came over and did it.
Obviously, Squid Game has been massive, as you know. I mean, this is internationally. How has that directly impacted your lives? And not just in terms of work and opportunities, but at home as well.
Well, my work was doing all right before Squid Game. I was relentlessly marketing myself and kind of feeling my way around the Korean media scene and starting to work my way up when Squid Game really took off. So mostly what it's done is created more interviews, a lot more notoriety, I guess, of course, visibility. And that helps always. Of course, you don't want to be too visible. If you're oversaturating the market with yourself, people get sick of you. But so far, that hasn't happened with Squid Game, fingers crossed. It definitely has increased the number of strangers contacting me on Instagram and calling me daddy, which I guess it's connected somehow with the character I portray on Squid Game, which is this sex-obsessed, robe-wearing, rich ne'er-do-well. Is that the most polite way I could describe the guy? Yeah, so far it hasn't really impacted a ton. I mean, I guess I couldn't be sure, right? I don't know what's being said about me behind closed doors. And I was getting fairly decent numbers of opportunities before all of this started. So I did get I did recently book a pretty big part in a sci-fi series that's filming in the States next spring. And I probably wouldn't have gotten that without the visibility and the cachet that came with Squid Game. So that's definitely a big part of it. Yeah.
Well, it hasn't done anything at home for me. I live with my teenage son. You know, it's been remarkable in reference to my career. You know, I do these interviews every day, around a couple a day, I guess, on average. So I am intent upon squeezing every last penny and opportunity I can out of this, because it was absolutely accidental, like a car accident, bit of karma that came into all of our lives that was beyond our control. We didn't see it coming, like a car accident. Right. And it's probably not going to happen. Well, it's not going to happen again for me. I'm way over 60. So I'm trying to utilize this to get the maximum bang out of it. And so far, it's going very well.
John?
Well, at home, my wife has had to deal with me constantly fretting about my IMDb star meter. But other than that, it hasn't really changed anything at home. But as far as my career is concerned, you know, it's weird. I'd gotten fan mail before. Mm-hmm. But never anything like this, which was a little crazy. And, you know, it's weird. Jeffrey and I have been talking throughout this whole thing, and we have very, very different approaches or demeanors as it relates to this stuff. But I was a punk rocker when I was younger. I was in bands and I, you know, put out a bunch of records. I used to tour all over the place. And I had always had this, this idea of fame that I never wanted to be famous. I always wanted to be kind of like cult famous. Like I wanted people to discover me. And then once they did, to be like, to hold me as some precious thing that they had discovered just on their own. And this is like a kind of an outmoded, old fashioned idea, because there's the internet now. So who gives an F? Because everybody can find that stuff. And I actually have kind of had a change of heart very recently. And I've kind of been, and I'm pointing down at Jeffrey on my screen here. And I kind of am actually looking at Jeffrey for some inspiration in this regard, that I kind of feel like now I'm probably feeling more inclined to like step out into the spotlight a little bit more. You know, we have this, I think everybody, a lot of us have this feeling that, oh, if only we could do something good for the world in some way, you know. And the thing is, I actually have just been handed this power that I mm-hmm. could be doing something. So I actually sent an email out today, and I hope they respond positively. There's a group here called KUMFA. Korean Unwed Mothers and Families Association, that when I first came here 9 years ago, I had volunteered for. I met these Korean American adoptees who were here, mm-hmm. And I was just chatting with them over lunch one day, and I was saying, I'd like to do something meaningful while I'm here. And they're like, well, if you want to volunteer for this, that'd be great. And so I did. And it was basically babysitting while the mothers went and did things. And I just did that a few times, but I couldn't speak any Korean. I didn't understand the culture. So I wasn't very good at it, but I was raised by a single mother, and I really, that made a big impact on my life, obviously, seeing my mother struggle in the 70s as a single mother. And when it was like a bit of a rarer thing. And so I'm going to see what I can do to kind of capitalize in this, to try and do some kind of giving back. And then, and I also would like to capitalize for my career as well. And my cat just jumped down.
Yeah. And I do want to say one thing at the end, Jeffrey and I, we are actually splitting some of the proceeds from this podcast for a couple of different organizations. So we would like to add yours in there as well, but we could talk about that at the end. And lastly, my very good friend, Mike, he's actually the best man at my wedding. A lot of people don't know that.
It's Victor Overfluff. And if you tell people I'm your friend again, I'm walking.
All right. Oh, we got Garfield. Everyone say hello to Garfield.
Don't you dare say that about Caroline. Oh, she's so offended. She hasn't eaten lasagna a day in her life.
Mike?
I forgot the question. Are we still in the speed round?
Yeah. How is this?
Yeah, maybe I took some speed. Jesus, I'm talking so much.
Anyway, well, like John said, watching the IMDb meter
is so
fun and entertaining. I gained about 300,000 positions.
Unbelievable.
And it took me 3 attempts to get IMDb to even believe I was in the show. But, and I've been taken out to lunch a couple times by former students. And my family actually responds to some Facebook posts. They comment on it.
I thought you said they responded to your messages.
It's amazing. My Facebook has gone from 0 to 7 or 8 replies to posts once in a while. And that's about it. I'm not nearly as good at these guys as milking this, but then I don't really have as much.
Jeffrey's the hero milker. He's the one who knows.
So one thing, actually, Jeffrey actually got his mask. So
I don't have the mask.
Oh, you don't? Okay.
I have the robe. And I have the storyboards and the script.
Okay, so my friend here, Mike, he's married to a Korean, and I believe John's married to a Korean. So I'm pretty sure your wives would appreciate it if they do get the mask. No, Mike, no. Okay.
If we're not allowed to cuss, we're not allowed to rip you off either.
Next question. Moving on right along to the next question. Okay, so. Like, clearly nobody saw this coming. Like, if you ever want to talk about catching lightning in a bottle, and I will say this, speaking about Korea and Korean film and things, pop culture, Psy was the first person ever to reach 1 billion views on YouTube. And when that came out here in South Korea, when it got to 1 million views, like South Koreans went crazy. They're like, wow, we cannot believe that this guy actually got like 1 million views so quickly. And so then he wind up just blowing out of just unbelievably out of proportion. So seeing that happen to something you're in, like I know you've been in other films. There's no way you saw this coming, what happened. So what has been like your response to seeing this reaction to being the number one most streamed of all time on Netflix, which is the biggest streaming network of all time? So what do you think about that?
I was shocked.
Yeah.
And I don't know, this guy's probably equally, but our scenes were very different from the rest of the show. So
yeah.
It was very surprising to me that the show was as good as it was and that it was as popular. I don't know. Are Koreans as into it as the rest of the world?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's huge here.
Yeah. Yeah. It actually, yeah.
I haven't watched the news.
I just sent, and I'll post this picture right here, but I went to get some actual squid, like to eat the actual, like the animal. And
Oh, Jing.
They were milking this one because it had the little triangles and circles. What was your response to seeing the outrageous, the outrageous reaction?
I was terrified. The thing is that you and I talked about this on the phone yesterday. As far as Korean stuff becoming popular, I am 100% Team Korea. This is my land of opportunity.
Yeah.
And that has been very good to me. Right. And I every time there's something when I'm on YouTube, if there's any, I watch a lot of cooking shows on YouTube. If I see anything that says Korean something, I got to watch it and then, watch how they're talking about Korean stuff. And I get all weepy and everything, I have a certain amount of pride, I guess,
right,
about Korea that I never had about the U.S.
What was your response?
The success of Squid Game wasn't an instantaneous thing, It wasn't all of a sudden it was successful. It seemed to build, in my understanding, my experience anyways. Because it was first came out on Netflix, and then I was, excited to see myself on Netflix, and then it started to become popular in Korea, and that was fun. Clients and agents and stuff were like, oh, I saw you on TV. That was nice. And then it started to become more popular globally, and then it just took off. And each of those stages had a completely different feel to it, especially once it started taking off globally and the criticism of the VIPs went online. That was a bit of the downfall for me with how I felt about the success. But it was also an opportunity to be able to, be like, wow, yeah, Netflix does have a much more global reach than we've ever experienced before with a lot of media. And so you're being exposed to a number of different criticisms because everybody has a different way of, imbibing their media, and everyone has completely different standards by which they judge the entertainment that they consume. So it was a lot of different experiences and a lot of different responses that I had as it took off. And I'm still kind of processing it all because, it changes from day to day.
I saw it as an opportunity to try to move the needle. I'm trying to always get as much as I can to go forward in whatever it is I want to do, not for my own reasons, but mostly for my son. There's no mother here, so it's everything's dependent upon me. And I'm, so much old. My son's 14, I'm 68. I have to be very assiduous in planning for his future, because obviously he'll be a young man when I shuffle off this mortal coil, and he's going to have to be prepared in every arena of life to carry on without me. So that's why we've had to kind of accelerate the process of parenting so that he'll be okay. I push him really hard. So I said, listen, man, I'm not going to be here. You got to know how to do this stuff, And there's a few things I tell him. I tell him, after I'm gone, don't ever loan people money that you don't want back. Be a vegetarian.
That took a while to get me.
don't smoke cigarettes. Don't ride on motorcycles. Don't take any drugs.
Did you see The Earthling with William Holden?
No.
It's with a young Ricky Schroeder. William Holden. Ricky Schroeder gets trapped in the outback, and William Holden finds him. He's out there wandering in the outback to go die, and he has to teach this young, very young child how to survive in the wilderness in order to carry on without him.
And see, I'm a Sicilian New York hustler, and my son's a very genteel, very honest, sort of waif-like, Buddha-like guy, and I'm really afraid that people are going to play him. So I'm trying to toughen the kid up, which is a line from Goodfellas. We got to toughen that kid up. You wasted 10 aprons on this guy. So yeah, that's not going very well because he's a nice guy. And I'm not sure that this world is a place for nice guys. I'm certainly not a nice guy.
Is it true that you didn't know about the nude scene until the day? What happened?
Okay, so I don't care about these movies. I do one, you know, they hire me to do a movie. I don't care about it. You know, I care about doing the best job I can do. I don't care about the plot. I don't care about anything but my own little corner of that movie. So I did the casting tape, but I didn't bother to read the script. I did what I had to do. It got me the part. I took the script and just put it aside. So when I got there, this girl that was assigned to me, she said, "Are you ready for your big day tomorrow?" I said, "Yes, I am." She said, "Okay, it's going to be a big day." And I went, "Okay, it's going to be a big day." "Yeah, because we're going to have somebody there. Don't worry. When you take your clothes off, we'll have a blanket." What are you talking about? "Well, you know, when you take off your clothes and show your genitalia on Netflix, we're going to have someone there to put it. Don't worry, we'll have a blanket." "What are you talking about?" So she said, "Well, you know, the script. Didn't you read the script?" No, I didn't read it. Why would I read? No, I did not read the script. But I did my part. I got the job and that was it. And she said, "Well, no, you got to take your clothes off." I said, "Dude, I'm not taking my clothes off." She said, "You want this money?" I said, "Yeah, I'll take my clothes off." So I went there and, you know, it was a weird thing because usually they have like supremely unattractive 35-year-old males with a stubble and a little thing in their ear and they're the headband and they're the production guys. But on this thing, they had all these beautiful 20-year-old girls in that room.
Oh, my God.
So, I mean, there's like really beautiful Western girls in there. And I just had to take my clothes off and they put a little cup over my penis and they had to they taped it down, but that was
a
all
done. Cup?
Yeah, it was a very small cup. That's right.
Okay.
So that was one thing. Another thing was that guy, I guess his name is June. That guy was one or maybe 3 or 4 inches away from my penis. It wasn't like a camera angle where, you know, it looked like he was that close. He was that close. And I thought, I took a shower. I put the soap on 3 times. So there's that famous picture where I touch his chin and he had this really like eating lemons his face. And I'm sure there wasn't much acting involved in that. So, but a lot of people asked me, "Did he squeeze your scrotum?" And I said, "No, that was just fake. You know, they just took his hand. They just shot his hand going up, and
yeah,
and I pretended that it hurt."
Yeah. So speaking of, you know, speaking of being there on set, I gotta say, so about a month ago, Mike and I went out for some Taco Bell, and I was like, "Hey, you gotta watch Squid Game. It's so good." And Mike's like, "Oh, I was actually in that." And I was like, "You're kidding me." Like, I was shocked. He's like, "Yeah," he pulled out his phone. He starts showing me the set. And I'm like, "What kind of set is this? This is like the craziest, most elaborate set I've ever seen in my life." So you want to speak a little bit about that set? What were your impressions of it?
Yeah, it was definitely amazing. We were all shocked when we saw how they, I mean, the beauty of it. They put a lot of money.
Wow, I know.
Those little couches we sat on and our body painted slaves. I was surprised. I've never seen anything like that.
Right.
Set,
right.
But I don't have the experience you guys do. What did you guys think?
Well, I was amazed. What amazed me was when we went into that hallway at the top of the stairs, that the walls had a sort of molded plastic sheeting on top of there. I mean, maybe you can buy that, but I mean, even if you can, it's very expensive. That they might have just formatted that, especially for that hallway. It was this sort of wavy acrylic plastic, and anything acrylic's very expensive. The other thing that impressed me was there was a ceiling on part of the set. I've never seen a ceiling. There's just lights up there normally in a
right,
scrim, which is a curtain that goes around. So, and then when I was sitting on the sofa, all this intricate painting of forest and birds and deer and everything that was painted there on the set.
I also was blown away by the set. It was incredible. The detail that was put in, you know, it's the kind of thing where you build, I'm sure that they did the storyboard beforehand, you know, that was very well storyboarded. Yeah. So like when you're talking about the ceiling, I'm sure they had a storyboard of this is going to be a low angle. So we're going to need a ceiling here. And, you know, because they're going to like they want us to look imposing or frightening or whatever. And then but yeah, like it was really set up. The main room was really set up that they could take the camera and point it in any direction. That's what was. That is real production value. You know, you can, if you can point the camera in any direction and have a great shot, that is what you want. And so I've worked on, I actually have worked on a few sets that were like that. I've done a few commercials that were really kind of elaborate. There's a lot of like a sci-fi commercials here, or like you, maybe you'll do like a you know, like a CIA office, that kind of thing,
right,
where
right.
You know, all the you know, monitors everywhere and stuff, but this one was the most unique. Having that ability to point the camera anywhere is amazing anyway, but then also this was just so unique, and that uniqueness was in every direction too.
Squid Game was built around, you know, something that's ubiquitous, which is childhood. And so the show has a lot of bright primary colors, you know, the guards in those bright pink uniforms, real bold coloring, and everything's kind of childish looking. The sets, everything speaks to childhood. And I know everybody is different all around the world culturally, but children are tend to be raised and approached in the same manner by adults, which is, you know, bright, bold colors, primary shapes, that sort of thing. And of course, centering the show around children's games. They may not be the same games that we would play in other countries, but they're probably similar, and everybody has children's games, and that's so that resonates as well. And so even though you have a lot of different cultures that respond to a lot of different things, everybody used to be a kid, or still is. And everybody used to have those childhoods where it was all those bold colors and primary shapes and basic kids games.
This has been one of the most unique things, like the elaborate colors, the elaborate dressing, like your mask. Those masks looked like they were really heavy, right? Or is that just like camera?
Oh, they were brutal.
They were heavy, and they had no field of vision.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Like Jeffrey, I don't think you know this, but you probably saved all our lives. The first day when we came back to shoot all those scenes.
Walking down the stairs.
They expected us to come in at the top of these crazy stairs. I think they were three stories high, that had that same real slick sheeting on it that you were talking about on the walls, Jeffrey. The floors were slick, and they wanted us to just walk in naturally and just go down these stairs. And we have a field of vision. It's like closing your fist and looking through, and about that thick too. Yeah. So Jeffrey refused.
I looked behind him
and said, "Yeah, what he says."
I won't do anything that's dangerous that I perceive as dangerous on a set. I just say I won't do it.
So speaking of which, though, if you're saying that mask was really heavy and you could hardly see,
yeah, no depth perception at all either.
It makes sense why the acting was so bad.
What are you talking about? There was no bad acting on there. What the hell are you talking about? No bad acting for me, I'll tell you that.
I think he was joking, Jeffrey. He was only joking,
okay,
man.
Well, yeah.
He was only joking. Yeah.
Joking about my acting, man.
Yeah. Okay, no, fair enough. That's fair enough. You're a long way, both of you, a long way from Hollywood. How does your environment compare? And where, you know, South Korea as well, there's a lot to be said about its comparison to Hollywood.
And I don't really know that much about Hollywood, right? I don't have a ton of experience. It's all about South Korea. But I do know that recently, about the past year and a half, I was in an acting group with a woman who came from Hollywood to Korea, because when COVID hit, a lot of stuff shut down in America and a lot of the entertainment industry was struggling. Whereas in Korea, things were, Korea did a fantastic job with COVID right up top. And that's the reason why they were able to continue filming and making such great content. I mean, Squid Game was made during the COVID era. So she came over here looking for work. And in her words, she said, compared to the American entertainment industry, the Korean entertainment industry is like the wild, wild west, which, you know, you're kind of on your own. Every man for himself sort of attitude. There's not as much oversight. There's not as much regulation. There's a lot more things go on handshakes and you know, word of mouth. There's far fewer like paper contracts, I've learned. And so as a result, there are fewer protections. I mean, it means there's less red tape, and a lot of it is about who you know, and I'm sure it's like that in the States as well, but I know here it takes a lot more strength of will and trust and faith in others and those you work with, whereas in the States, so much more is, you know, bound to legal documents and to precedents. And there's also not a whole lot of support system for foreigners here. It really is a kind of a struggle in that sense. I know that when I get depressed or when it feels like it's a nonstop struggle here, it's tough because I don't have a whole network of people that I can go to for comfort or inspiration. Whereas I know that sort of stuff is everywhere in the States if you know how to look for it. So that's kind of a bummer about the situation here. But again, if you're an enterprising and industrious person, you can still make it work. I'm learning that. So I think that's the same in both places.
Whenever anything comes in this region, not whenever, but very often, whether it's Kuala Lumpur or India or Korea or China or Thailand or Cambodia, they call me. I'm a known quantity. They know that I'm a character actor and I can do this kind of stuff. And if you put an ad in Backstage Magazine in Hollywood, we need 10,000 guys that are almost duplicates of Jeffrey Giuliano, you get 20. So, you know, I don't have any currency in Hollywood, because there's guys that are married to casting directors like that. The guy who made Sling Blade, whatever his name is, you know, he married the casting director. So there's people that nepotism in Hollywood. There's people that have been there for years. You know, you can't. I went to Hollywood at the invitation of an agent about 4 years ago, and I ended up sleeping in a rental car with my then sort of 8-year-old son on Malibu Beach parking lot. And then we would drive to Vegas during the week when those beautiful suites were like $80 as opposed to $1,000. So, you know, I got out of there real quick. I have a really good life here, and everybody calls me, you know, now, since this, I hope I didn't upset that guy too much, but you know, I can't let anybody say anything about acting, you know, either for John and for me and for him, Mike. So anyway, look, so, since this has happened, I now have a Hollywood agent. I have two agents and I have a manager. So, you know, that's come out of that. But I'm a big fish in a small pond. And over there, I'm just a tiny fish in a huge ocean, and I won't get any work.
That's certainly true. You know, when I'm auditioning for stuff, I'm auditioning against, you know, I'll hear like, how many people were out for this? And they're like 50. And so like I'm getting a part, you know, where I'm beating 49 other guys, but in America it would be 5,000 or,
yeah,
you know, 10,000 guys who are going out for the same thing. So hopefully this has, you know, bumped me up in that list of being looked at, but we'll see. But to speak to the differences between the two places, when I was in LA, I was working both in LA and New York. I was working in, I worked in theater, but I also worked in independent film and commercials. And so I was on a lot of sets doing that kind of stuff, but I wasn't in front of the camera. I was behind the camera. I was, you know, working. I did a lot of art department, actually. I used to build sets and I built miniatures. And, but I also did some, we call swing. I worked electrics and grip, where I did both And I they call that swing. Anyway, I did electrics as well, which is lighting. And so what I found about here is that the Korean, even at the highest levels of Korean cinema, it's very much like working on an indie movie in America. Like the way you kind of just throw yourself into it with zero caution, you know, you just, everybody, sure. That's been changing while I've been here. In the 7 years or so that I've been working in the industry here, that has been changing where, like there's safety standards now, where when I was first here, they would literally soak rags in gasoline, put them all around the set, wet down the set, give you a steel sword and say, when we say action, you just run and start swinging your sword at these guys. And then one of you die. And like, that was all the direction you got. And it was chaos. People were getting hurt all over the place. But now there's much more attention to safety. And every change that's happened here in the time that I've been here has been super rapid. Like the level of like just general safety and public safety stuff has just increased dramatically in the 9 years that I've been here. And insane within the film industry. Like the Korea is on like fast forward in terms of like, you know, they were probably at like, I don't know if they were like in the top 30 countries or something when I moved here, and now they're like number 13 or number 11 or something like that. And they're just zoom. So, and what they're doing now with the Parasite and Squid Game, and yeah, they got their stuff together. They're really pushing it.
So I want to break this up with a few more lightning round questions, but what is your favorite 90s hair band?
You know, we're all in our 50s, right? And 60s.
Okay,
90s. We'll go to 90s. Jesus.
Right, how about, okay, Adam, they invented rock and roll in the UK. So Adam, what do you got to say?
Oh, Oasis, hands down. And I'm sure Jeffrey would agree with that. I mean, they continued the Beatles train, man. Surely.
Jesus, that's not even getting back to the 90s. Man. That's like 2009 or something.
Does Duran Duran count? I guess I'm not sure what the definition of a hair band is. I know Haircut 100, Flock of Seagulls, but Duran Duran, the Wedding Album. I don't think it was a bad song on that entire album. I listened to that endlessly when I was in high school. Great album.
I played my first show in 1986, and I had hair down to here, so I'll just say myself.
Okay, all right, and last one. Worst boy band of all time. I'm going to go with just a toss-up, NSYNC or New Kids on the Block. New Kids on the Block, I'll say that. They started the nonsense. But Mike?
No, they didn't. This goes back to the 50s. That they would take these sort of Fabian and these guys, and they would hold auditions, and a bunch of guys would say, "Well, what do you think, Joe? Yeah, I like this kid. We're going to use this kid here. That's a kid." And they would, you know. So the reason the Beatles were special was they were organic. They just sprang from the earth, fully formed. It wasn't any. Well, Brian Epstein put them in suits. Okay, there was a bit of a sellout there, but you know, basically in terms of talent, they just came. So all boy bands suck. Going right back down to who at Frankie
Avalon. You know, that's a really good
crap.
That was a good answer.
You know, like it's like saying Led Zeppelin is a boy band. You know? Yeah. There's music and then there's this other thing, but you know, so
that's the best answer you've given so far. Okay, John.
I don't really have an opinion on this, I don't think. Okay. I think that it's like I agree somewhat with Jeffrey in that, you know, I think they are different things, but I don't want to invalidate that thing. If people are into it, they're into it. It's just not my thing.
And that would require me knowing a lot about pop boy bands. I know that's sacrilege, me living in Korea, not being really into boy bands, but I don't know. They all look and sound the same to me. I remember growing up, my cousin Angie was a huge fan of NSYNC, I think it was. And I would always get under her skin by pretending not to know if she was talking about the Backstreet Boys or NSYNC. I would always pretend like I thought she was referring to the Backstreet Boys and drove her nuts. Anyways, never really got into the whole boy or girl band stuff. They all just seem like cookie cutter stuff to me, you know.
What do you think are some of the deeper, like, implications about a Squid Game that wind up, do you think people have really connected with that? Or I think
it's a dystopian tale about a world of death that we live in, a world of darkness, a world of hopelessness, a world of airborne viruses, a world of global warming, a world of school shootings. People have become insular. They stay in a little room and they're afraid to go out because there's a mask of the Red Death. There's a plague that will kill everybody that's airborne. So it's a dystopian tale for dystopian, hopeless dying times on a dying planet spinning in the universe.
That's an interesting take. What about you, Mike?
It was a job that I actually knew nothing about the whole context of the show anyway. So yeah. It was entertaining when I watched it. And for probably a lot of the same reasons Jeffrey brought up, but I tell you, it's actually a shock that it was as popular or has become as popular as it has. But,
do you see similar themes between that movie and you had mentioned Parasite being the first non-native movie to win best film picture back in America for the Grammys, or the Oscars. But do you see like a similar theme with the Parasite, just this class warfare and
I think that's a theme in Korea. Mm-hmm. Maybe as much or more than the rest of the world. It seems there's a lot of that feeling here among Koreans I know.
See, here's the thing. What's the difference between South Korea and North Korea? North Korea is a couple kilometers up the street. And there's a headspace. There's a headspace, you know? They got this headspace, you know? So the collective, no rugged individual. We all must work for the total thing that's happening. And well, you think that you go down a couple miles down the road and they're all, liberated? They got the same goddamn headset, man. It's just North Korea that's a little bit south. That's all it is.
What have you thought about the overall themes of the story?
I don't know. I think one of the things that occurred to me watching it is that, there's always revolution. I don't think we're done having revolutions. And as the struggle with the upper and lower classes continues and as resources and money continue to, get stockpiled by one group and taken from another, part of me thinks that the popularity and growing fame of Squid Game speaks to the feeling of desperation that sometimes is the impetus behind many revolutions. And in a show that's all about violence and treating other people's misery as entertainment, I think it speaks to that that impulse people have to be like, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to get out of these circumstances. So part of me watching it, the show, and then watching the success of it spreading around the world felt sort of like a precursor to that. Like, we read the history books about all the different times in history when the poor people rose up and we're like, well, that's in the past, but it's not really, right? I mean, we're deluding ourselves if we think that we're in a position now where all change happens gradually and safely. And so unless and until people can start to come to terms with the way things are right now and how dissatisfied a steadily growing number of people are with circumstances, then I think the deeper social implication is that there might be another one of those scary violent revolutions coming in the future. If we can't find a way to make the change happen safely and gradually and assuredly, it's going to happen suddenly and explosively. That's what history bears out.
Let me first say, in terms of the themes of the show, I think Jeffrey put it well. That's the same way I see it. I think that's kind of the general view that most people take from it. And the way I've described it in the media in the past is that it there's this feeling that we're all a bunch of have-nots being pitted against each other to scramble for crumbs while the mega-rich just kind of take everything for themselves and the world is dying. I do think that some of the problems that are happening here in terms of how we are treated and kind of, you know, because how we're treated as foreign actors is across the board to all actors. And there is an actors union, but it's not very strong. And, but I'm hoping that this international attention will maybe start to change some things. We'll see.
It'll change some stuff. It'll change.
And then, like I was saying about with public safety, how that's changed so rapidly and dramatically in the time that I've been here. The same thing is happening culturally as well. Like, there are so many things that are happening so quickly, but there is a certain inertia here that is based on what Jeffrey is saying about this whole collective thing. There is an inertia here that's based, I think, this is, once again, I'm an outsider, or I'll say for the first time, I'm an outsider, I'm a Westerner. This is my opinion from what I've seen, and perhaps somebody would feel completely different, but... Yeah. To me, it seems the inertia comes from the Confucianism, which has these kind of built-in hierarchies of looking to the older people all the time, or your boss is always right, that kind of thing. And so the reason when somebody says like, oh, you don't talk about gay, the reason you don't talk about gay is because that it suddenly puts everybody on edge because they're wondering if the people above are going to have any issue with it or how they're going to be judged by the people above. So I think that's something that's slowly changing. There are companies that use English names, or they will speak English. In that way, you can kind of remove the kind of embedded Confucianism that's a part of the language, because the language itself has that hierarchical structure so that it kind of enforces it when people are talking to each other. So a lot of this stuff that he's talking about is there, but it's all kind of changing, and it's very actively progressing as we speak. So I don't want it to be, I'm just pushing back against this characterization as if it's some kind of frozen in time place, because it's not. It is changing very dramatically and rapidly.
Just a real brief, I had a job, I'm filming a Disney Plus series called Moving, a fairly decent sized part that required me to learn a lot of lines in Korean. Anyways, I was waiting to film one of my scenes, and one of the agents that was on set was communicating with Anupam, the guy who played Ali from Squid Game, and he kind of laughed and shook his head, and I was like, what's up? And he's like, the guy, Anupam, had of course raised his rates, you know, obviously he got like, I think 2 million followers overnight, basically. So yeah, the guy's popular now. He draws a lot of viewers. So obviously he's going to raise his rates. But the agent seemed to think that was, you know, unwise, at least to the size, to the number, which I'm not going to tell you, because I don't want to get this guy's business out there. But anyways, the agent was like, no, he shouldn't have done that. He's not going to get much work. And I was like, what, really? He's on one of the most famous shows in the world. He's one of the most beloved characters. He did an amazing job. Doesn't that level of success and fame warrant that kind of pay? And the agent kind of laughed and shook his head and said, you know, yeah, all that's true, but he's still in Korea. And I was like, I think that was when it hit me that the success of Squid Game is something you kind of have to mold, at least in this country, and shape day by day into something. It's not like a guarantee of anything, which is unfortunate, but that's kind of how it works here. It's not just because of the success doesn't mean there's a flip that's switched and all of a sudden everything is better. But I'm learning, and I'm sure he is and everyone else, that there are ways to leverage it and to slowly bring it into something that's profitable, but it takes time and it's a learning process, right? Trial and error.
What does it feel like to play such horrible, horrible characters? Like, this is pretty much like the epitome of just every last thing you could possibly think of a character being wrong. Literally, people are dying right in front of them, and they're joking about sexual positions and stuff like that, and they're only interested about betting for people. I mean, it's really is hard to watch some of the times. And I know we can separate, you know, this is fake, this is reality, this is not reality. But did you have any kind of apprehension behind that, or do you feel like anyone's going to make any kind of association with that with you? What are your thoughts on that, Mike?
I'd like to actually play a truly horrible character someday. Yeah. I think we barely tapped into that. And yeah. I actually, when Netflix sent me a user survey asking, it just happened to dig into what would you like to see in season two. I said, I really want to see the VIPs.
Have to play the games.
Get really, go deep on the VIPs. Let's really get to know them and let them get really evil.
Yeah.
Because it's the potential was there, but yeah. That wasn't our purpose in this season. It was just to sort of touch on that possibility, but they didn't really go into it.
They didn't count. They didn't count on the VIPs making the impact that they have globally. You know, we were just kind of a throwaway thing they put in there to kind of be a negative to their positive, you know, a kind of like the way we give Asians the evil triad of the Asians in our movies, you know, it was the same kind of evil like they do in China, you know, the evil American president or whatever. So this was a kind of a reverse racism or racist thing and at some
level. Yeah, it is.
I don't care. But they didn't count. Nobody counted that people were going to be really interested in the VIPs.
Right.
I personally don't think it was reverse racism, but I do think that it was, you know, playing. I play a lot of evil white guys here, you know, evil rich white guys. I think that there is a reality to the world that probably the majority of rich people are percentage wise based on their makeup of the world. Okay, so there are more rich white guys per the white population than of any other population on the planet. And they do more effed up S than any other group on the planet, I would say. Like, you know, if you are hoarding billions of dollars and if you are 62 people that have more wealth than the bottom half of the world's population, and those people are struggling to find fresh water, well, you're a fucking prick. I'm sorry. I mean, an FNP. I'm sorry. That's like... And I believe in the functional, you know, you can characterize people functionally. Those people may in their individual nature as a human being may not be that bad, but functionally they are a pure psychopath and a pure cancer on the planet. So like it's the vast majority or the large majority of those people until maybe very recently were old white guys. That's just the reality of it. So if you're going to make something that's showing the callous evil of the world, and you were to throw darts at evil callous people in the world, you most likely are going to hit a white guy, an old white guy. So I don't have a problem with that. That's just the way of the world. And
well, thanks a lot, old white guys, for just setting up we younger generation people with
we all got screwed by old people and we're all continually getting screwed. And now all the young people are totally screwed. So I don't have a problem with that at all. Like, and I don't think it's reverse racism. I think it's just the way the world is. And so, but I'm not a rich guy and you know, and, but apparently people here think I look like a rich white guy.
I'm not an evil rich white guy. Yeah. I only play one on television.
But apparently my look is like evil rich white guy. That's the look in Asia. That's what everybody thinks I am. They say you're an evil rich white guy.
I thoroughly enjoyed the series, and to have even to speak to you guys for a few minutes. It's been really insightful, especially talking about, you know, your backgrounds, where you live and things like that. Jeffrey, I've spent quite a lot of time looking into your books and all that recently, and fantastic. I'm going to continue with that. I think my final thoughts would be about series two, because, you know, obviously you guys might not know anything yet. But my final thoughts is we need to give the viewers something here. So open to the floor. What series two? What's happening? Anybody know?
You know, I the only time I did an interview for TMZ, and the only thing they used, it was never on TMZ. It was on one of their like side website things, and it was you know, something like VIP one, John D. Michaels dishes about season two. And it literally was me just saying, I don't know what's going to happen with season two. I'm not in the loop. And I got no other answer besides that. Jeffrey has heard some stuff.
All right. All right, John, let us take over. All right. I want to dish. I have no clue. They won't tell me. They don't care to talk to me. Who are we? I'll take the headlines for you this time.
Will you come back? That's the question. Will you come back for season two?
If I'm not more famous by then.
John, will you come back for season two?
Of course I would, yes.
Jeff?
If they give me six figures, yeah.
All right. And so can you tell us really quick how we can find you online? Do you have any social media that people can look you up? Oh. IBM, you said something about IBM.
Easiest for me is just imnotmarvin.com is my website. And look for me. Hey, and you, John, we're going to be in theaters in the U.S. in our next movie. I know it's my next. I assume it's your next, too.
I think I got something else coming out before that. But, yeah.
They go to the website.
We'll put a link to it. John, do you want to tell us about that organization you are working with and any social media you got or any websites?
Well, I haven't heard back from them. But whether they get back to me or not, KUMFA is a great organization. KUMFA. So I you know, everybody, you should give them money, but you can go to my YouTube, which is just John D. Michaels is the, I guess, search that on YouTube. I don't know what the numbers and letters are for it, but yeah, if you search John D. Michaels on YouTube, you should come up with my channel. And on Instagram, I'm sudden_a. I really should probably change that. So it's and then also which we didn't touch on at all. I'm also a writer and director, and Soul Cellar Productions. That's Soul as in the city I'm in. Cellar as in basement, CELLAR, productions.com is my production company. And I've got like four of my short films on
there. Yeah, you told me about that.
You come to jeffreygiuliano.com, GeoffreyGiuliano.com. If you want to find me on Instagram, it's Jeffrey Actor, GeoffreyActor. And I'm very interested in doing photographs for legitimate media outlets like this, he said, tongue in cheek. And so I'm happy to do whatever for anybody that wants me to do something within reason.
And actually, I just created a link tree for you, linktree.com/Jeffrey Giuliano, where you can find all your information. But do you want to tell us about the GoFundMe that we're starting for?
Well, I don't know what the addresses are, but I'm building a house for a lady who lost her husband. She's 69 years old. She was a farmer in Thailand. She's completely without any means, indigent. And we're building her a house, which we need about $5,000 to finish. I've put in $30,000. And we just, you know, it's getting a little bit tough for me to continue. Sure. So we need another $5,000. And if anyone gives any money to this project, I will post the receipts and they will equal $5,000. Whatever we get, I'll post the receipts and they will equal the same. I don't need money. But, we don't live very long. You know, we're just here for a second, just a second. You know, like you see these ants that have a whole life and 30 minutes. That's what we are. There's no difference with that. We perceive it as all these years, but it's just a flash like that. So if there's something we can do that's good, that's lasting, I think we should do that. It's not difficult. Yeah.
Well, we're going to put a link to that. And then what was the PayPal that people can donate? You want to just say that real quick?
I don't know.
Okay. So we'll post that. Also, I am RHE Podcast. we're bringing people together who have different views. Adam over here is an atheist. I'm a Christian myself. I believe you're an agnostic or something. And Jeffrey, you're a Hindu. And so we just bring people together.
He's not a Hindu.
I'm a Hare Krishna. Krishna is what I am.
Yeah. So we bring people together to have conversations. And so one of the things that we're doing is we're also supporting, nonprofits, and we're also doing humanitarian work. So one of the things I'm doing right now in India is helping to dig a well for fresh drinking water for underprivileged people. So we're going to make links available for all that. Now, if you like and share and comment this video, we're dividing a third of the revenue to what Jeffrey's doing to his organization to this project, which is digging this well in India, and then also to the amazing organization. And by the way, my mom was a single mother as well, so I think that's amazing. My mom actually had my brother prior to meeting my father. And so you can check us out at www.righpodcast.com. Check us out on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Spotify, just about anywhere you can find someone, you can find us. And we thank you so much for watching today. Really appreciate your time. You've all coming from all over the world right now. And so just really appreciate your time that you've taken off to do this, Mike, a very good friend of mine. And
I told you, I'm walking. No, I'm
okay,
he did warn you.
Yeah, so we look forward to seeing season 2, and we look forward to seeing you back again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thanks, guys. Thanks.